Today we're going to take a look at the Lumineux Foremark High Bay light fitting.
Looks a little bit different, Gary.
It is a little bit different. Okay, where would you like to start then, Gordon?
Well, in front of us here we've got a high bay light, and it has everything you'd expect in a high bay light.
Go on,
a few more things. But before we get onto that, yes, it's a 14,500 lumen high bay at 100 watts. Also available in 150 and 200 watt versions. Range of beam angles 90, 120 degrees. But Gary, I'm going to convert this one in front of your very eyes from a normal switch on and off high bay to one that has integrated controls.
So I take it these are the integrated controls here. We've got a PIR and a microwave sensor. Yeah. How about you fit the PIR for me then, Gordon?
Well, it could be complex, Gary.
Yeah, I'm sure it is.
Are you ready for this?
I'm ready.
Well, let's have a little closer look at the camera to watch it. Might be here sometime.
Okay.
So the first thing I'm going to do is remove this little threaded barrel at the moment.
Yeah.
In the middle here. Take that out. Get the sensor here. I'll start with a PIR version. You'll see it's got a little jack plug here.
Yes, okay.
And a threaded barrel.
All right, I've got a funny feeling this ain't going to take very long.
And then I'll just turn that into that threaded jack socket in the middle there. There you go. I've converted it to a PIR control.
See, I didn't get that one, did I? What's the advantage to us then, or the customer, for having PIR control of our high bay light?
Okay, well, what's the most efficient type of light fitting?
The light that isn't on.
Yeah, exactly. And so we're thinking high bays, we're thinking a lot of applications where there might be massive spaces, but low density of people in there. So, you know, a few people drifting around in a massive warehouse and some of the factory spaces with all the lights on isn't a very efficient use. So fit controls, and obviously significantly reduce that energy consumption.
So let's think of an example of that. Maybe I'm in a warehouse, we've got racking either side with these high bay light fittings, and obviously it's got low occupancy. What would happen with no people in the room? What could we do with these sensors?
Okay, so this is, it's one sensor per fitting
in
this variant. So as you walked along that row, each fitting would trigger on its own PIR sensor and obviously go from zero or a low light level up to 100% light level.
So we could set it then using the remote control.
Yes.
That each of these drop down maybe to 10% when there's no sensor activity.
Yes.
I come into the area and it raises maybe up to 100% depending on what you set it to, and it'll only be in that area. So as I walk down the racking, I would actually see the lights brighten up as I move down.
Yeah, it'd be a cool effect, wouldn't it?
Yeah, it would. It'd look really good.
Yes, and you can tailor that function with the wireless remote control that goes with this. So you can the time it would stay at a lower level, perhaps then a time it would go fully off. So that's all configurable in there.
And all of the fittings are able to be converted, aren't they? They all come exactly the same. We'll look at another feature in a minute that they all come with as well, don't they? So we could have it as a standard high bay, or I could introduce one of the controls.
Yeah, so you just do the plugs. I'll do another one, Gary. Convert it to...
I'm worried the amount of time this might take, Gordon.
I'll convert it now from PIR to microwave. If you don't know the difference between PIR and microwave sensors, we have got a video on that. We'll put a description in the link.
Okay, that's that one done as well.
There we go.
Didn't get much technical stuff this time. That's really easy, isn't it?
Yeah, then that's a great solution, and not more. So this is the sort of first generation of this product. Next year, they're bringing out a smart enabled one where the fittings will talk to each other using a Bluetooth mesh network.
Ooh, looking
so
forward to that.
You can have all sorts of interesting scenarios across an installation there, and obviously some more complex controls, perhaps better if there's in a warehouse that's got more people in it and more things happening.
Okay, I'm sure we'll get to review that on the channel. Depending on when you're watching that video might already be out. You never know, do you? However, that's a couple of really good features, and that was really simple as well. So you got those ones, Gordon. When we flip it over, there seems to be something added to the actual fitting itself.
So obviously in a warehouse, there's other types of light you'd want to fit.
Yeah, there is, emergency light fitting.
Yes, and normally how would you normally do that in a warehouse?
You'd normally have those two spotlights and maybe a small suitcase, perhaps on either end of walls, etc.
That's it, a classic twin spot. And obviously try to find a high bay light that you can convert easily to emergency LED. Not very many of them on the market.
I think we found one.
Till now.
Okay, so this fitting comes with the ability to put the sensors in, but it also, every fitting comes with the ability to be converted to an emergency one as well, doesn't it? Whether you use it or not.
Yeah, that's it. So you can buy your fittings and then configure it on site to the options you need for a particular installation.
So this pack's been added, and obviously we've made the relevant connection. Should we have a look at that footage?
Let's have a look at that.
So let's go about attaching this battery pack to this light fitting then, Gordon. So we've got our flex. Our flex has got our connections here, line, neutral and CPC, and we've got our lead that goes to our emergency element of the fitting. Bring in the battery pack here, and I'm going to need to make some connections. So first of all, I'll do the IEC connector. So I'm going to connect my line and neutral and CPC into that. A couple of key points here, obviously when you separate it open, you've got to remember this little black shroud. Nothing more embarrassing than making all the connections and find I didn't fit that. So let's put that on first, slide that over the connections, and then I can make the connections into the IEC connector, and then we're on to the second part. So let's whip it apart.
So that just plugs into your battery pack when you're done, does it?
It does, yeah. So that lead would normally be 1.5 meters in length. It could go to a click ceiling rose or something like that. But for this one, we're obviously going to come through the emergency pack itself. So connect those up. So nice and simple, nice ferrule ends you might have missed there, Gordon.
Oh yeah, you know you like to put a ferrule on things, Gary, make your life easier.
Connect those up, obviously reconnect that, and then that's going to go into the pack itself. So nice and straightforward. So here we go, just reconnect the cover on, and we're ready to introduce the battery pack itself. In order to do this, I'm going to have to remove the hook. So,
so that's the hook you'd normally hang it by?
Yeah, with the chain. So let's just loosen off the bolt in the side, the security bolt, just loosen that off and spin it out. And then you've got to introduce a couple of washers. That one comes out.
Okay, so you're going to trap that between the hook that normally hangs it from the ceiling.
Yeah. So they're my larger
simple
washers.
Simple enough.
Yeah, simple, yep. So large washer, introduce the pack. It's important now I get the pack the right way round, because obviously I've got my connector and I've got this lead for the emergency element. So if you look here, that's where the emergency element lead's going to go. So this one here.
Okay, so that's a low voltage DC supply to the LEDs within the fitting. They're separate LEDs, I believe, as well.
Yeah, they are. We'll see that when we illuminate it. So make sure we line it up correctly. And obviously reintroduce the washer and the hook. So just spin those two together, ever so simple process in order to do this. And then I would just suggest to remember just to do that little bolt up underneath next.
Oh yeah, just in case, yeah. It twists when it's hanging in the roof, you wouldn't want it come crashing down. So
no,
yeah, then just locks it off.
Yeah, so spin that, lock that into position. Again, that could be easily missed. So just take your time, get it done correctly. And now we can make the connection here that we just made into the side of the pack. So pull it round and we clip that one just in.
Okay.
And then just a simple case of pushing, and you've got to do a little twist motion now, Gordon.
Okay, so that's a little, I see that, yeah, you just insert that and turn it to, again, lock it in place so it's not going to accidentally come out. So yeah,
absolutely,
nice,
yeah.
Nice solution.
And then the flex itself has now got an extra core, so we have a permanent line, switching line, neutral and CPC in order that we can obviously energise the emergency pack as well as switch the light, the main light, on and off, Gordon.
That's good. Simple enough.
Yeah, okay, let's take a closer look then what we've got in front of us, Gordon.
Yeah, you were nearly as fast as me on the control wiring, Gary,
yeah.
You know you.
I spotted that mine took a lot longer and I had to trim it down in order to get that. Yours was really quick, wasn't
yeah,
it?
Yeah, okay, so yeah, let's bring the camera in, just have a closer look at what you did there.
Okay.
So, okay, so there's the IEC plug, yeah, and that takes the mains wiring out to the fitting.
Yep.
So obviously you shortened that lead down, so that normally comes 1.5 meters.
Yeah, because if it was being used as a standard high bay fitting, you're probably going to want to get it up to some sort of clicking arrangement.
So then that's the supply that comes in from, obviously now you've introduced the permanent live to it to charge the batteries.
Yep.
What I like to see as well, so you've got that, you can see the charge indicator on the side. That's actually.
Can you just show us a bit closer how that were detached and connected?
Yeah, so there's just the jack plug.
Yeah, just a simple, twist it back in.
So a nice big indicator there, you're going to be able to see that. You know, you wouldn't want a small indicator on a high bay all the way up in the roof.
Right, okay.
So we've done that and we've connected this to this rather nice looking grid switch arrangement here.
We've got our
switch live, so let's just make sure we can switch the light fitting on still.
Turn it on then for us. Okay, and then let's have a look at that. Yep.
Yeah, lots of light there.
Yep, okay.
Switch it off. So now I'm going to disconnect the live.
Okay, do the key switch.
The charge live connection. And there you go. And you see there's just an inner ring comes on there.
There is. And I believe that inner ring wasn't on when the lamp was under normal operation. Is that true? Yeah, it isn't. Yeah, you see that's a separate ring, Gordon.
Yeah, so that's just for the emergency light. So this output's about 600 lumens, depending on the optic angle you have in the fitting.
That's the emergency element, yes?
That's the emergency element, but that's a good punchy light output. Obviously, in emergency mode, you only need a few lux, and obviously at a certain uniformity to get the emergency lighting requirement you want. But having it built into the fitting means your lighting design's a lot easier.
Yeah.
Because it's the same distribution as the normal light fitting. You might not ever, every fitting is emergency, but it saves you having to do a completely separate light design with twin spots dotted around the place.
And you could have every fitting as an emergency fitting. You probably wouldn't.
Yeah.
But they all come exactly the same standard. So you can fit the sensors, you can fit the pack. So if you think you've changed the environment you're in, maybe you've moved all your racking around, you've bought another warehouse, you've knocked a wall through, all of a sudden the original emergency lighting pattern might not be one that you wanted. Just a simple case of adding packs in, moving them around.
Moving them around or swapping the pack over. And so this pack's got lithium iron phosphate batteries, so easy way. Not NiCad is the easy way to think about it. And we'll obviously give you a minimum of your 3 hour duration. Right. I think when we had this one on the bench, we got 5 hours out of it.
Okay. That's good.
We went home last night.
And talking of five, it's got a 5 year warranty with it as well, hasn't it?
Yeah.
So as always at eFIXX, we're interested in your comments. What's the type of high bay light fitting you're fitting? How do you accommodate the emergency element of it? Have you used this one from Lumineux, the Foremark range? We'd be interested in those comments. Please leave them below and we'll try and get back to as many as we can.